I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. Good evening, my brothers and sisters, and welcome to another Wednesday in the Word. I'm Mark Griffin, the senior pastor of Wayman Temple AME Church, and I am so blessed to be with you, and I'm so grateful that you have joined us for another Wednesday in the Word. And I hope what God has given me tonight will be a blessing to you. Why not reach out to someone else as you have logged on to encourage them to do the same and let them know that they can join us either on Facebook Live, on YouTube, on Vimeo, or they may go directly to our website at wayman.org to hear what thus says the Lord. I also want to take a moment to thank you so much for your generosity and your financial support of our ministry. I want to thank the faithful members of Wayman Temple for how you so consistently give your tithes and your offerings. But in addition to that, a number of our guests, many of you are also sowing into our ministry. And again, for that, we're thankful and we're grateful. Now, if you want to give in support of our ministry, we have established several ways for you to do so. First, you can go to our website at wayman.org, click on online giving, and follow the prompts that will lead you to our very secure online giving portal. Secondly, you can text to give by texting 904-844-0592. Thirdly, you can mail your gifts to our P.O. Box location, and that address is Wayman Temple AME Church, P.O. Box 56017, Jacksonville, Florida 32241. Finally, if you are in the Jacksonville area, feel free to drop your gifts off at either of our two campuses during normal business hours, our West Campus or our South Campus. But just know whatever method or whatever manner you choose to give, we are so grateful and we're so thankful for your support. Now, let's hear what God has placed on our hearts as we continue in this financial series. But before we do, let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we thank you, God, for yet another day. We thank you for your grace and we thank you for your mercy. We thank you for being our God and for allowing us to be your people. God, we realize that you are an awesome God. You are a loving God. You are a faithful God. You are a forgiving God. So we thank you for just being who you are. God, thank you for saving our souls. Thank you for continuing to look beyond our many faults and to see about our needs. God, as we prepare now to hear your word, we pray, God, that you would illuminate our understanding that we might receive what you have in store for us tonight. We pray, God, that you would forgive us of our sins. Help us to be the people that you are calling for us to be. This is your servant's prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Now, as we continue in this financial series, I want to do part two of a three-part closeout message entitled Your Financial Partnership with God. And last week, if you were with us, you might recall that I mentioned to us in part one that in order for us to be blessed in the financial realm, we must understand that there is a relationship or a partnership that we must undertake with God. God is not going to do everything for us by himself. But by the same token, we cannot do everything by ourselves without the help of God. So we have to be in a partnership, understanding what God's role is, and then understanding what our role is. We can't get the roles reversed or confused. We must clearly know what is God's part and then what is our part if we are to achieve in the financial realm, just as we strive to achieve in the spiritual realm and the other realms of life. So last week, we began to talk about God's role, and we talked about the fact that one of God's key responsibilities was the responsibility or the role of ownership. We understand that everything belongs to God. So when it comes to ownership, it is not a co-ownership or a shared ownership. Ownership solely relies and rests with and on God. Everything that we quote unquote have, we must really understand from a kingdom perspective, that it belongs to God. And so we talked last week at length about God's responsibility of ownership. But secondly, tonight, this is where I want to begin. I want to talk also about God's responsibility of control. So God has responsibility of ownership. He owns everything, but tonight, control. He controls everything. And I want to start off by making this statement and helping you understand, if you don't know this already, that nothing happens without God's knowledge. That's why we say that God is omniscient. He knows everything. Things may sneak up on you and me, but nothing catches God by surprise. So we understand that nothing happens without God's knowledge. And if I can take that a step further, everything happens by God's will, by either his perfect will or his permissive will. And by that, what I mean is that in God's perfect will, there are some things that happens that God makes happen. But then in his permissive will, there are some things that happen that God doesn't necessarily make them happen, but God allows them to happen. So some things are based on his perfect will. He makes it happen. But then there are other things, and perhaps most things happen under his permissive will. He doesn't make it happen, but God allows it to happen. And I'm reminded of a passage of scripture that I want to read to you, a familiar passage, but it sets the tone in this financial teaching. Romans 8:28, where the Bible says, "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose." Let me read that again. "And we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose." Now, let me unpack that. It's all things, not most things or not the things that we desire or we want, but all things work together for good. So in God's having control over everything, the good and the bad, it all works together for good. But look at who it works together for good for. It works together for good to those who love God, and to those who are the call. That's you and me. We love God and we are the call. So it all works together for good to those who love God and to those who are the call. But listen at this last phrase, "but it only happens according to his purpose." All things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called, but it happens according to his purpose, not my purpose, not your purpose, but everything that happens, it works together for good according to his purpose, because after all, he controls everything. So sometimes we ask ourselves, well, but why does God allow unfortunate things? Why does he allow difficult things to happen? Now, we're still teaching on finance, but you need to understand that even when it comes to the difficult things, they are still under the purview of God. He is still controlling everything by his perfect or his permissive will. So why are some reasons why difficult things happen? For first, one of the reasons why some difficult things happen is to accomplish God's intentions. So sometimes God has to allow some unfortunate things in our lives in order to accomplish his intentions. And one particular situation in the Bible that points to this is in the book of Genesis, back in the, I think around the 41st, 42nd, 43rd chapter, where Joseph is sold into slavery. And we know that story. Most of us know how it ends up, where God positions Joseph in a place at a time where he's able to literally save his family from a famine. But it started off with a bad situation where Joseph was sold into slavery. So sometimes, brothers and sisters, even in the financial realm, God allows us to go through what looks today as misfortune so that tomorrow he can turn it into our fortune. So sometimes things happen to accomplish his intentions, his long-term intentions. We see things as they unfold right now, but God takes a long-term view over our situation. And what looks to be bad now, over time, it can often turn out for our good. Secondly, he allows difficult things to happen in order to develop our character. Now, I want to show you here in the Bible, Romans chapter 5, the first four verses, they read as follows. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations. Hear this. Knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. So sometimes God allows things to happen because he's trying to develop us. He's trying to get us ready. So sometimes God will allow some type of financial misfortune to happen in our life because he's really trying to develop us and build us. So when he brings us back, when he restores, we have the character, we have the capacity, we have what it takes the next time around to hold on to his blessings that will come. A third reason why sometimes difficult things happen is sometimes God simply wants to discipline his children. And we find here in Hebrews chapter 12, verse number 11, it says this, now no chastening seems to be joyful for the present, but painful. Nevertheless, afterward, it yields the peaceable fruit of righteousness to those who have been trained by it. So again, sometimes God will allow us to go through some things, even in our financial situations, to teach us some discipline. So sometimes God will allow you to overextend yourself with debt in order that you would learn what it feels like to be overextended in your debt, overextended in your finance, and it should help you to build the kind of discipline you need so that when your credit recovers, when your income increases, you don't go crazy the next time like you did the last time. So that's why sometimes God will not always give you a holy bailout. We're talking about living in COVID where the government has been giving us bailouts. Sometimes God won't bail you out. Sometimes God will make you struggle through what you created on your own. But even in that, he is in full control. And there's a reason why he allows you to go through what you go through. Let me give you one other passage that I think is interesting. Proverbs chapter 16, verse 4 says this, the Lord has made all for himself. Yes, even the wicked for the day of doom. So God made everything for himself. He even made your enemy so that when he needs to, he can allow your enemy to check you, to bring you back, just like God made the Babylonians in order to correct the Israelites. So everything is made by God, is made for himself because it's about his purpose. It's about his plans, not yours, not mine, but his. So you got to understand that God has control. He has ownership, but then he has full control of everything that happens. And so we're talking about at this point what God's responsibility, what God's part is. Let me give you a couple of other scriptures and then we'll continue. The 125th Psalm and the second verse reads as follows. As the mountains surround Jerusalem, so the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forever. So just like the mountains surrounded Jerusalem, the Lord surrounds his people from this time forth and forevermore. Listen, brothers and sisters, you are not in control. God is in control. Proverbs 19 and 21, I want to give you some scripture because I need this to settle in your spirit So when God begins to work in your finances, you understand that God is in control. Proverbs 19 and 21. There are many plans in a man's heart. Nevertheless, the Lord's counsel, that will stand. So again, you can make all the plans you want, but if your plans are not aligning with the counsel or the plans of God, your plans will not amount to anything. And so you must understand that God is in control. A familiar passage, Jeremiah 29, 11. For I know the thoughts that I think toward you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. So what God is saying, I know what I'm thinking about. So even when you're going through some struggles in your finances, even when you don't seem like you have enough money to do what you want to do, God said, I know what I'm thinking. Even while you're struggling, even while things might seem to be short, God says, I know what I'm thinking. And guess what? Not only does God know what he's thinking, even in your struggles, God knows what he's doing because God is in control. And one more verse, the 22nd book of Psalms, 28th verse, says this, for the kingdom is the Lord's, and he rules over the nation. So understand, it all belongs to God, ownership, and he rules over the nation's control. So two of God's responsibilities are ownership and control. Two responsibilities that are not yours are ownership. You own absolutely nothing. And control. You control absolutely nothing. It's according to God's plans and according to God's purpose. So if you're going to make it in the area of your finances, you must understand, you must yield to God's ownership, and you must seek God. You must pray to God. You must ask God, God, help my plans line up with your plan. Help me, God, because I realize that I am not in control. God, you are in control. So you got to understand God's ownership and God's control. But then thirdly, you have to understand that God is also responsible for provision. So he has responsibility for ownership. It all belongs to him. He has responsibility for control. Nothing escapes God. Nothing gets beyond God. But he has also responsibility for provision. He owns it. He controls it. But every now and then he will provide to us. So I want you to think about we won't put this on the screen, but a key verse here for you to understand is Matthew chapter 6, verses 25 through 33. Again, we won't read it, but basically in this passage, the familiar passage of scripture says, it says, don't worry about your life, what you're going to eat, what you're going to drink. Don't worry about your body, what you're going to put on. It goes on to talk about the birds. Think about them, how they don't plant, they don't harvest, they don't gather into barns. Yet your Father feeds them every day. And he said, and about your clothes, think about the lilies of the field. They don't toil or spin, but yet Solomon in all of his glory was never dressed. He was never as glorious as the lilies of the field, which spring up today and die tomorrow. And so it goes on to say, so now think about that. Are you of little faith? If God so clothes the grass of the field, if he feeds the little birds, don't you know he's going to take care of you? So don't spend all your time worried about what you're going to eat, what you're going to put on. It goes on to say, even the Gentiles, or what it's basically saying, people who don't believe in me, people who are unsaved, even they seek after those same things. But then it concludes with this, but seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added or shall be provided to you. It speaks to the provision of God. You don't have to worry about whether or not God is going to provide. God will provide. God has always provided. You wouldn't be listening to me right now if it were not for the provisions of God. So it's the God who owns. So he can't provide if he doesn't own, but he owns it so he can provide it. And he controls what he gives, when he gives, and who he gives. But know that God will always provide. That's why we call him Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide. So understand, when God provides for you, when God gives to you, it still belongs to him. So I need you to look at it as God consigning something over to you. But it still belongs to God because he is a provider. And the wonderful thing I like about when God provides, God can take so little and make so much out of it. So don't stress out because it seems as if someone has more than you. If you take the little that you have, if you take your two fish and your five loaves of bread and give them over to the Lord, God can bless a multitude with just a little bit. But you have to understand that it is God who provides. You don't own anything. You don't control anything. And guess what? You don't provide even for yourself. You receive the provision from God. This, I want you to think about this. You don't even provide life for yourself. Every morning that you wake up, that's why we say morning by morning, new mercies I see. You don't even provide the ability to wake yourself up in the morning. After you've slumbered and slept all night, it is God who wakes you up. It is God who provides you the ability to see another day. Philippians 4:19 says it like this, "And my God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." He shall supply, listen, all of your need. That's why God says, why are you worried? Why are you worried about food and drink and clothes when I've got the little birds that are flying? They're not worried. The lilies of the field, they're just beautiful. They're not worried. So why are you worried when I'm going to supply, listen to this, all of your needs? That's what the word says. You have to know the word of God. You have to receive or engraft the word into your heart, in your soul, in your mind, in your being, in your daily living. And then you have to trust God at his word, that his word is true, that he shall supply all of your needs. See, the problem is, and I don't have time to delve deep into what I'm about to say, but sometimes we confuse needs with wants. And so there's some things that we want, that we want them so much, we have deemed and declared those things as being needs. But no, God shall supply all of your needs. And guess what? He will even supply many of your wants because he is a God who supplies. God loves providing for his children. If you are a parent, if you are a mother or a father, you take great pride and great joy and providing for your children, doing things for your children, especially when your children have made you proud, when they brought home that report card and their grades were good, or when they've done what you've asked them to do. But the Bible goes on to say that if you know how to provide good gifts to your children, don't you know that your Heavenly Father knows how to do it and even do it even better than you? And so he is a provider. He is a God of provision. So you must understand, my brothers and sisters, that I begin to wind this message down, that there are certain responsibilities, there are certain roles that belong to God. And one of God's key roles and responsibilities is the responsibility of ownership. The earth is the Lord's, the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. Everything belongs to God. And so when you stop trying to own things and give them over to God, not only do you realize it belongs to him, but now all of a sudden you're not worrying about things like you used to. You were worrying about them before you came to the realization that they really belong to God. And God knows how to take care of everything that belongs to him, including you and including me. Secondly, you understand that another one of God's key responsibilities is that of control, that nothing slips past the mind of God. He allows everything to happen either through his perfect or his permissive will. And even when we don't understand why things happen the way they do, we have to trust God at his word in Romans 8 and 28 and declare that all things are working for the good of those who love God and those of us who are the called. But it's going to work not according to our purpose or our design or our wishes, but it's going to happen according to his purpose. So we understand that God is in control of everything. I don't know about you, but that takes a burden off me. That lightens my load when I understand that I don't have to control anything. It's all in God's control. But I also understand that a third key part of God's responsibility is provision. That God will provide. God has provided. And God will continue to provide. He allows us to receive. He allows us to have. He blesses us. And I don't know about you, but I can honestly admit God has blessed me more than I could ever deserve. And I know I could never earn it. It is just the graciousness of God, the loving kindness of God, that he continues to provide for us. And I understand even when he provides to me, that he's still not transferring ownership of his to me, but he's simply allowing me to use some of his glory, some of his blessing. So I understand now, as I look at my finances, that there's certain things that simply belong to God. And so even as I try to improve, and as you would try to improve your financial self, you must stay down on your knees. You must pray to God. You must go to him and ask God to help you line up your financial plan with his financial plan, which is all found in the word of God. Because you cannot be successful in God's eyes. You cannot be successful in your finances if you do not do it God's way. The Bible talks about having good success, which suggests to us that there is such a thing as having bad success. Let me touch on that, and then we will conclude for tonight. What God is saying is that God doesn't want you even to become a millionaire by obtaining that in a bad way, or in a successful way that's really a bad way of success. He doesn't want you to cheat and steal and do things that are against his will. That's what I would call bad success. You know, when you receive like that, you have to constantly look over your shoulder and wonder what's going to happen. But God wants you to have, and he wants me to have, good success. He wants us to have the success that is good, so that when he blesses us, we can rest at night. When he blesses us, we don't have to worry about somebody showing up and taking it all away from us, because we understand that those blessings and those gifts and the financial increase, it didn't really come from man. It came from God, and it came from following godly principles. And that's what we have to do. And godly principles are based on God's ownership. Godly principles are based on God's control, and it's based on God's provision. Listen, if God doesn't provide, it won't happen. I don't care how much you work. I don't care how much you save. I don't care how much you strategize. It has to be based on God's provision, and has to be within the realm of God's purpose and control. And at the same time, you must always understand, I don't care how many bank accounts have your name on it. It still all belongs to God. So we understand now. Hopefully we understand a little better of God's part, of God's responsibility, or God's role. Now, God has never gotten it twisted. He's always known his relationship and his partnership and his role with us. The key tonight is for us to understand what responsibilities and roles, as it relates to our financial affairs, belong to God. And what we learned tonight and what we learned last week, that what belongs to God in terms of our financial affairs, what belongs to him and what his responsibilities include are God's ownership of everything, God's control of everything, and God's way of providing to us as God allows some of his provisions to come to us. I will talk with you next week to help you have an understanding. Now that you understand God's role and God's responsibility, what is your part? So we thank God for his word, and we hope that this has helped you to understand that even in the area of finances, God plays a critical role and has a key part to your financial success. Next week, we will learn what's your role, what's your responsibility. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your word. We pray, God, that your word has not fallen on deaf ears, but he who has an ear, let them hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying. And help us, God, to not just be hearers, but help us to be doers of your word. We pray, God, for financial increase. We pray, God, for financial knowledge. We pray, God, for financial stability in our lives. So we thank you for your word and the power of your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. There may be someone who's watching this broadcast tonight who does not know Jesus as Lord and Savior of your life. Before we go, I want to give you an opportunity to accept him as your Lord and Savior. How can I accept him, Pastor? I'm so glad you asked. All you need to do to accept him according to the word of God, not according to my word, but according to the word of God, confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord. Then believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead. And the Bible says, if you do that, you shall be saved. That's number one. Number two, if you don't have a church home and you want to be a part of our church family, we thank God for the increase that God has been giving us. But listen, even if you're not in Jacksonville, you can be a member of Wayman Temple as we continue to worship the Lord virtually on this platform and others. All I need you to do is give us a call at either of our two campuses. Our South Campus number is 904-739-7500. And our West Campus number is 904-693-1503. Or if you are on a platform that will allow you to comment, such as Facebook, put something in the chat that will give us the opportunity to